the issues affecting you. Revealed, explained, discussed. Now on WGAL 8 In Focus.
Hello, I'm Susan Shapiro. The cost of food, gas, and housing have all gone up considerably. It's a challenge for people with limited or fixed incomes to find affordable housing. Tonight, we'll take a look at the problem and speak with a man who's having trouble finding a home he can afford. We're putting affordable housing in focus. Joining me now is Colleen Adams, who's the Vice President of Programs at Water Street Mission in Lancaster. Thanks so much for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
Colleen, what kind of situation are we in this country in terms of what we call affordable housing?
I think we're seeing things we have not seen in many, many decades in terms of availability and cost for people to actually find something that stays within what their budget can afford.
What do we consider affordable housing?
Well, that's interesting. I mean, if you think about guidance that most of us have gotten, you know, when we go out, you know, leave our parents' home and get our first apartment or living situation, you usually look at housing being about 30% of your total income, and that generally includes utilities. So that's the best guidance. For people living in poverty, it's not uncommon that that goes up to 50%. And even sometimes higher, but we would not view anything over 50% as being affordable and would really prefer that people are more at that 30% mark, so that they have the money to live and, you know, avoid emergencies and that kind of thing.
Obviously, there are other expenses, and
absolutely,
of course, with inflation, everything mm-hmm. else is more expensive.
Absolutely. Yeah, it's making it very, very difficult.
I'll say. Well, yeah. And rents have really skyrocketed, haven't they?
Yeah, what was interesting for us, so we have a case management unit that works on works with the community. There's a lot of community providers that we partner with to work on around this housing issue. But it was interesting, towards the tail end of last year, I started to hear reports back that rents, we may have been able to get somebody in a room, in somebody's home, or even in an efficiency apartment for about $450 to $500 a month. Understanding that same individual probably only makes about $790 a month on Social Security or disability. And right now that price has doubled. We really struggle to even find efficiencies under $750 a month. So if you have $790 coming in, you're pretty much outpriced out of the market.
Maybe silly question, but why have they gone up so much?
Well, I mean, it's what's happened across the country, you know, in housing. I do think the eviction moratorium had a lot to do with, in Lancaster County in particular, but we've heard this from other areas in the region. Landlords basically bore the cost of people not paying them. The most they could get reimbursed from the government if they accepted it was about 80% of what they were owed, but then they had to write off 20%. And many of the landlords in Lancaster County are very small. They may have one or two additional units, you know, on their house. So they really couldn't afford to take the lesser amounts. And so, of course, a lot of people out of business. And then I think for people who have a high profit motive, when you watch the demand, you started to see, you know, prices. I think when I had moved to the area in a townhouse, that townhouse for a three-bedroom was about $1,500 a month. I just heard that same townhouse is going for about $2,200 a month. And so it's just shocking in such a short period of time, you know, how drastically things have increased.
It's amazing. I mean, in some cases, a mortgage might be less than the
absolutely.
Rent.
Absolutely. Yeah.
And is there a problem in terms of what's being built or, you know, any kind of new low-income or affordable housing?
Definitely. It's very, very costly to build affordable housing in terms of just all the regulations. And then in Lancaster, where do you put it? So the process, like Water Street, we're in the middle of our strategic plan right now. And as we're even looking, you know, at the whole affordable housing piece, more related to some of our guests that are kind of being stuck at Water Street much longer, you know, it's probably a 3 to 4 year pipeline for us to even find a property to rehab that we could even, you know, start to impact the situation, but we wouldn't even put a tiny dent in it if we did that. There's some really good groups like HDC, who that's their whole goal is providing affordable.
Housing Development Corporation.
Yes, yes. And so, I mean, that's what they're working in full time, and they're struggling to bring up affordable housing, even in mixed kinds of settings. You're seeing some of that come up in the city. So our need, building at the pace that we're building, we could never satisfy the demand for housing. And so Lancaster has its own unique piece around not having enough housing, which is probably more connected to land, and that is not as strong in some of the other cities and missions that we partner with around the state. But for us, it's pretty significant.
It's frightening that people mm-hmm. just have nowhere to go.
Right. Yes. Yes. Yeah.
Well, we'll talk more about some of the guests you do have at Water Street Mission. Okay. And first up, we're going to speak to one of those guests who's been living at the mission for about 2 years now.
This is WGAL 8 In Focus, coverage you can count on.
Joining me now is Michael. He's been a guest at Water Street Mission in Lancaster for about 2 years now. And thank you so much for being willing to share your story and
Welcome.
Joining us here.
Pleasure and honor.
You're originally from Philadelphia.
Right.
Tell me about your living situation there and what happened.
Well, I kind of was in a fire after coming back from a tour on the road with a band, and everything that I had was destroyed, including money I took out of the bank to open up another account.
Wow, that was a place you were renting?
Yeah. So I had no renter's insurance, so, you know, go figure.
But so you were basically homeless at that point?
Homeless at that point. I had stayed in my truck for a couple nights, and I owned a pest control business, and a friend of mine from Lititz called and said, why don't you come up and stay with us, and, you know, we have the room, and we'll help you get on your feet. And on my way up, I was in an automobile accident, hit a telephone pole, you know, saved the fox's life, but I find it to be a blessing because I ended up at Water Street, where some other things following up with clinic there.
How did you end up at Water Street? What happened with your friend you were living with?
Well, they're not in real great health either, and I after I was released from trauma, I had to go back. That weekend I was released, go right back in the hospital on a Monday with a major bowel obstruction.
Oh.
And so we won't get into the details of that, but I ended up back in the hospital. My first like 2 weeks in Lancaster were in Lancaster General Hospital, and then I ended up at Water Street, and following up with their clinic there, did some blood panels and so on, and discovered that my prostate numbers were quite high and I had prostate cancer.
Wow. So you've had a string of what you would say is bad luck.
Well, some would say that, but I'm looking at them more like blessings. When you're aware of something, it's I think more positive than not being aware of it and not knowing of. I had to pretend to 15 years and didn't know it. So when I found out I had it, it shed it light on a lot of things that didn't have answers, and now they do.
What about not having a place to call your own apartment, your own home? What's that like?
It's really scary because you sometimes feel like you're walking on eggshells because you know, you have to follow rules and regulations, of course, and that would probably be anywhere you go. But at Water Street, it's a little different because you're living in a community with other men. You don't know what everybody's dealing with, and, you know, you have to kind of be careful what you say sometimes, or, you know, your body language might say something that you're not really meaning. So you have to be pretty aware of what's going on around you all the time, and, you know, try to be as positive as you can, and when you see negativity, just don't get caught up in it.
Mm. So, you know? Communal living can be a little difficult at times?
Oh, that can be. It is. It is. It just is difficult. But, you know, if you have a good mindset, I think it's a lot easier to deal with than not.
How do you manage to keep that positive attitude?
Oh, constant prayer, meditation, and reaching out to staff when they're available. And I have a lot of guests that are, you know, we befriended one another. And so I have a really good network of people around me that know where I am and know what's going on with me, and they're there like pillars, you know.
So if you didn't have a place like Water Street, where would you be in terms of housing?
I don't know where I'd be. It's just so difficult out there to find something affordable. you have to have some money saved up in order to pay the 3 or 4 months that they want in rent now because of the COVID thing with them losing their properties, for not, people not paying rent and so on. And so I really don't know where I'd be if it wasn't for Water Street.
Well, stay with me here, Michael, and we'll talk about what the future holds for you and what it's been like to look for affordable housing.
This is WGAL 8 In Focus, coverage you can count on.
We continue our conversation with Michael, who's been living at Water Street Mission in Lancaster for about 2 years now, after a number of setbacks, but he still maintains a very positive attitude. Michael, where do you see the future for you in terms of a place to live?
Well, in my sight of positive and hope and being hopeful, I see something coming. I just don't know where or when, but I have some things that I'm thinking and dealing with what I would like as far as a place to live and call my own, be able to get up and have coffee whenever I want, or, you know, sit outside whenever I want. It's, I guess the conditions are important. The neighborhood would be important. It's just kind of being able to be open-minded to where you may end up, and it may not be what you're looking for, but it just may be the place that'll get you to where you want to be.
What's it been like? I know you said you have been looking around to try to find housing.
It's been extremely difficult because the application process, in my experience, is very difficult. You pay these fees, and there's multiple buildings that they have, and they want an application fee for every individual place that you may show some interest in. But my fixed income, that's like pretty much just unable to happen for me.
What is your fixed income, if you don't mind me asking?
$841 a month is what I have to live on. And thank God for Water Street. It's, you know, it's a stepping stone for sure.
What do you think in terms of what is out there for folks like you? And
not a lot. And what is out there, they don't make it readily or easily available to find. It's like jumping through hoops, you know, like filling out these applications are a process of where you end up on a waiting list, and God only knows how long those are. I put out 3 applications. I've only been contacted by one who, number one, don't work with your income ratio, and their rent goes up $30 every year. Hmm. So there's the first one that contacted us to do the application process isn't going to work. So that's something out there that's taking place where, you know, you put an application fee out there. Now, there is money I could have used somewhere else that was just wasted because not knowing what they deal with and what they don't is not on the table.
How can anyone afford what's out there?
I don't know. I really don't know. I don't have an answer for that question. It's just, I have to thank Water Street because, you know, the understanding and the way that they operate is so individually based on each person's case. And if they treated everybody the same, it would be a whole lot of chaos and uncertainty. And the way they deal with everybody individually, I think sets a precedence of, and it offers an immense amount of hope that they're watching you, they're paying attention to you, and let's deal with you the way you need to be dealt with, as opposed to if they dealt with me the way this guy's being dealt with, may not work for me. So each case is individualized, which I think is very important, and grateful that they do it that way because I've been able to set my, you know, I'm on a rail, and like I can see light at the end of the tunnel. You know what I mean? Mm. And the light is quite bright.
Well, that's good. How's your health doing? How are you doing?
I'm in remission. I deal with a lot of body ache from the injections that I get. But I hold and maintain a positive attitude because I don't think I was put this far to be dropped.
Let's hope not. What do you think, quickly, what we need to do in this country to make housing, more affordable?
I think
affordable.
There needs to be more communication with the big people that are in charge of doing that, And I think they need to work together a little bit more, be more open-minded, and maybe do what y'all were doing and listen to the people that are caught up in it and get our side of the story that may help them figure out a way to make it better for everybody that needs it.
Well, we hope it gets better for you, and we thank you for joining us. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
This is WGAL 8 In Focus, coverage you can count on.
And we are back now with Colleen Adams, who's the Vice President of Programs at Water Street Mission. We heard from Michael, a real series of events that happened to him. Mm-hmm. Is that kind of common for the folks you have at Water Street?
Yeah, his story, I always say if you've met one homeless person, you've met one homeless person, which I, prior to working in homelessness, would have believed there was a type, and they all kind of had similar issues. And the reality is, you know, we have anything from PhD scientists to, you know, people who have come out of poverty and have cycled through homelessness for years. So big, diverse group of people. But in his story, what you could hear was there was a tragic event that happened in his life. He's trying to settle through that tragic event, which was the fire. And in the middle of that, he has another tragic event, you know, with the accident and then the discovery of a lot of things that were happening inside his body. It is not that uncommon. And our nurse care management program, which is part of our healthcare clinics, has probably had the most rapid growth of any of our programs because the population is becoming sicker, needs a lot of medical
support. They're getting
supports,
older, I guess, right?
Getting older, you know, and so we have had people come oftentimes because of their medical condition, because they really aren't eligible for rehabs or even, you know, nursing care. And so they come to Water Street because they don't have another option.
Now, he described getting $800+ in Social Security and trying to find possible housing.
Yes.
And it seems almost impossible.
Yeah, well, it is almost impossible. I think as we've talked to other partners and people are just looking at our community to say what is going to happen, especially with seniors as they're getting older, they can't afford big houses. Can they downsize? Well, you know, I know somebody who has a 4,000 square foot house wants to downsize to just 1,000 square foot townhouse, and the cost, because costs have risen so much, it's almost a wash if they move to the smaller place and they were gonna use some of that money, you know, in their retirement. And so it's really, really interesting dynamics.
Yeah, so it's affecting on young people who can't find a housing?
Absolutely. I mean, young people are tending to stay with their parents quite a bit longer. But, you know, I think some of the concern is long-term. There's no easy solutions. There's no quick fixes. Subsidized housing in our particular county is very interesting, that when the lists open, to get on the list, usually Water Street will know the list is going to open, happen several times a year. This time we thought we had a day to get as many people on the wait list, which you might wait 2 years for housing with the subsidy. It closed in 2 hours. They had 4,000 applicants in 2 hours, and so they shut down the waiting list. So subsidized housing is not a real good option if you're in crisis and homeless. I mean, it's a long time wait list. And then our other challenge is we get some block grants into our community from HUD, you know, from the federal government, that are for emergency services to help what we call rapid rehousing. And people get a voucher and they get to use that voucher, and their rents will be paid through that voucher. They'll pay on a sliding scale, you know. The problem is the vouchers, let's say, go up to $750, and most of the apartments are over that amount. So even the voucher system since early 2021 is not necessarily working for low-income folks.
Mm, wow, yeah. It's very difficult, obviously.
It is.
I know
it
you
is.
Mentioned some of these folks like Michael might find a roommate and find a place together. Is that an option?
Yes, families, that's a little bit more difficult, you know, to co-locate. There are a few more resources for families who are homeless, not much. I mean, you still have costs, but sometimes they have some additional sources of income that are coming in. But if you are single, we are seeing and encouraging people to find one or two roommates to go out with. What you heard in Michael about the community of Water Street, we often hear from our guests, they don't want to leave. They found, because our guests are our family. I mean, we're all brothers and sisters in the Lord. And so clearly, we're not higher up because we're staff. We all love each other. And so that sense of community is really important. And so for them to move out with several other people is actually really, really helpful, even for that sense of community. But it's definitely becoming necessity from a cost perspective.
Mm. Well, I assume the goal at your mission and elsewhere is to get people to be out on their own in a home of their own.
Yeah. I mean, our goal is to address the issues, the underlying issues that cause people to become homeless. And so that once they're out, I mean, the home doesn't always solve that problem.
Right.
A lot of the other issues, if we're addressing those, then when they get a home, hopefully they're going to be able to stay there. So we don't want to see them back. We welcome them back with open arms if that happens. But, you know, our goal is definitely to see them able to stay. And I think secondarily, we want to see as many people rise out of poverty as possible. So we have programs like our Step Up program that is very geared towards career development, financial areas. And so, yeah, the goal would be they are able to maintain where they are.
Not easy, all of that, especially in these times, that's for sure.
Right, right.
Well, Colleen, thank you so much for sharing some insights with us. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us for WGAL 8 In Focus. For all of us at WGAL, I'm Susan Shapiro. And join us again next Saturday night at 7 o'clock for WGAL 8 In Focus, right after NBC Nightly News. And you can watch each episode of In Focus, plus WGAL's latest newscasts, original programming, and more. Just download the Very Local app and stream for free on Roku and Amazon Fire TV.